We have come to the last unit of this course on electronic system design, that is on digital filter. Now, in this particular unit, I will touch upon some basic characteristics of digital filter. Now, to start with, let me just give you the idea of any filter. Forget about analog filter or digital filter. In fact, you have seen that in the very first unit on RC circuit, we have developed some analog filters using R and C networks, using those passive devices. And in the unit 3, while talking about the op-amp circuits, we have also seen that the low-pass filters and the high-pass filters can be generated, can be designed with the aid of op-amp, resistor, and capacitor. Now, if I just consider the notion of a filter, as you know, the idea is to allow a certain range of frequency to pass through it and suppress the other band of frequency. So considering it to be a filter, in case of, as you know, the term filter suggests that it should filter out something. That means it should allow something and it will surpass some other things. Like if I just consider the input output, so this is the input signal applied to the filter circuit, and this is the output signal. Now, while talking about the notion of the electronic filter, then obviously here the idea is to allow a certain range of frequency to pass through it and suppress the other band of frequency. And accordingly, we can have the different types of filters, like we can have a low-pass filter, a high-pass filter, band-pass filter, band-stop filter, and so on. Now, as the name suggests, for low-pass filter, it will only pass the low-frequency component, and it will provide very high attenuation to the high-frequency component. Similarly, for the high-pass filter, you will find that the high-frequency components will be passed through it, and the low-frequency components will be attenuated severely. And similarly, we can have the other types like the band-pass filter and band-stop filter. So that is a basic notion of filter, and everybody is well aware of this. Now, what makes this digital filter different from the filter circuit that we have already discussed in some of the previous units? Now, in case of a digital filter, it will accept the input as the digital input, and accordingly, it will also produce the output in the digital form. So the input signal corresponding to any filter circuit, for corresponding to any digital filter circuit, is nothing but a sampled signal. So I can consider the input to be, say, x of n, and the output is y of n. So instead of having a continuous time signal, so if I assume that my signal is a function of time, in fact, the signal could have been the function of anything. It could have been the function of space. It could have been the function of both time and space. And it could have been the function of any independent variable. Now, for the time being, if I assume that the signal applied to the filter circuit is a function of time, then instead of having a continuous time signal like x of t, we have x of n. That means the x of t is sampled, and accordingly, the sampled signal is being provided to the input of the filter circuit. So x of n is the input, and accordingly, it will produce the output as y of n. And the conversion from this x of n to y of n is basically done by means of this filter circuit. Now, for the time being, let us assume that this filter circuit that we are talking about is a linear time invariant system, or LTI system. You must be knowing what is the meaning of a LTI system. If I assume that the filter is an LTI system, so LTI means the full form is linear time invariant system. So the term linear must be very clear to you, that whenever we say that the system is linear, that means it must obey the law of superposition. That means the law of additivity and homogeneity must hold good for a linear circuit. And what do you mean by time invariance? So whenever we talk about the time invariance property of any filter circuit or of any electronic circuit, that means that the response of the circuit is not at all sensitive to the time at which the input is applied. That means if I apply the input at time t is equal to t naught, suppose the input is x of n, and at time t is equal to t naught, I have applied the input, suppose the output developed is y of n. Now, if I just delay this input by some unit, suppose I delay the input by, say, t double dashed, then the output resulting from the filter circuit will be the same output, same previous output, and delayed by the same amount of time. That means for any time invariant system, sorry, I think I have made a mistake while writing. It should be invariant. It's not variant. Linear time invariant. It's a linear time invariant. So for time invariant system, if I consider that this is the system, say TI, time invariant system, and the input to the system is say x of n, and the corresponding output say y of n, that is fine. Now suppose I apply some different unit, like if I apply like x of n minus say capital N, so it's a different input signal and applied with a delay of n sample, then the corresponding output for any time invariant system should be y of n minus capital N. That means you'll be getting the same signal y of n, but delayed by the same number of samples. So you don't be getting any some y dashed or y double dashed over here. So that is the basic concept of any time invariant system. Now let us assume that the filter circuit that we will be discussing in this particular module is a time invariant system as well as linear system. So let us consider any arbitrary input x of n, and you know that any arbitrary input x of n can be represented as x0 delta n plus x of 1 delta n minus 1 plus x of 2 delta n minus 2 up to infinity, assuming that the signal is causal. That means the signal starts from n is equal to 0. So that can be written like, it's nothing but a summation x of k delta n minus k, where k is ranging from 0 to infinity. In fact, k can range from minus to plus infinity, but assuming that the signal is causal itself, that means signal starts from n is equal to 0 onwards, then it can be written like x of k delta n minus k. That is all about x of n. Now suppose I apply this x of n to any LTI system, and suppose I know that if I apply, suppose this has been applied to any system, like suppose the input is x of n. Now, suppose let us assume that if I apply this delta n only to this particular system, the corresponding output is equal to h of n, which is known as the impulse response of the system. So that's a single experiment that I have to perform before characterizing the system. The same LTI system, the input being applied is delta n, which is nothing but the unit impulse function, and the corresponding output is h of n, that is the impulse response of the LTI system. Suppose the result of the single experiment is known to me, that if delta n is input to the system, the corresponding output is h of n, and the system itself is LTI, linear time invariant system. So now, if I just invoke the property of linearity and the time invariance, then you'll find that because of x0 delta n, the output should be x0 h of n because of the homogeneity property. Similarly, due to the input of x1 delta n minus 1, okay, let me start with only delta n first. So if the input is delta n, the output should be hn. That means if the input is x0 delta n, then the output should be x0 h of n. And that is coming from the homogeneity property. Now the time invariance property says that if the input is delta n, the output should be hn. And under this condition, if the input is delta n minus 1, then the output should be h of n minus 1. Because the same output delayed by the same number of samples. So therefore, because of delta n minus 1, the output should be h of n minus 1. And what about the output due to x of 1 delta n minus 1? The output should be x of 1 h of n minus 1. Then what about the output because of this combined input, x0 delta n plus x1 delta n minus 1? So this is nothing but x0 hn plus x1 delta n minus 1. Then ultimately, the output signal that we will be getting over here because of this input x of n. So if I write this one as y of n, then this y of n can be written as x0 hn plus x1 hn minus 1 plus x2 hn minus 2 dot dot. Like mathematically, this can be written in a compact form like k is equal to 0 to infinity x of k h of n minus k. In fact, if I allow the input signal to range from minus to plus infinity under this condition, we can have a situation like this. If the input signal be represented, so in the previous slide, we have assumed that the input signal is a causal one. That means it starts from n is equal to 0 onwards. But if I do not impose that particular constraint, and if I write xn in this particular form, like xn is like summation x of k delta n minus k, where k is ranging from minus to plus infinity, and then the corresponding output yn, because of the application of this input to an LTI system, can be written as x of k h of n minus k, where k is ranging from minus to plus infinity. And this can be readily shown that this is also equal to summation k is equal to minus to plus infinity h of k x of n minus k. And in fact, this particular operation, summation k going from minus to plus infinity x of k h of n minus k, involves four different operations. One is, so first of all, you have to identify the different operations involved. I think I should put this one outside. Different operations involved over here. So you have to identify the different operations involved. So you have the sample signal as the input to the system. And what are the different operations? So the first operation that you can observe over here is known as the folding operation. Given h of k, you have to find out h of minus k. That is known as the folding operation, or time reversing, folding or time reversing, or time reversal. Then the second operation involved is from h of minus k to h of n minus k. So that is all about the shifting operation. So this complicated operation, complicated expression, involves four different operations. First operation is folding or time reversion from h of k to h of minus k. Then the second one is shifting operation from h of minus k to h of n minus k. Then the third operation, so I think it will be better if I just put the number over here. The first operation is folding, second operation is shifting. Third operation, as you can readily observe, is nothing but a multiplication, x of k multiplied with h of n minus k. Second one is a multiplication operation. multiplication, and the final operation is obviously the summation. The summation is an outside. So these four operations together will perform this complicated operation, and what is called in our language of signals and systems as the operation of convolution. So this combined operation is known as the operation of convolution. So mathematically, that can be written like y of n, the output of an LTI system, can be written as the convolution between the two signals. One is the input signal, x of n, and second one is the impulse response, that is h of n. So y of n can be written as x of n convolved with h of n, where x of n is the input applied to the system, and h of n is nothing but the impulse response of the system. As long as the digital system that we are talking about is linear and time invariant, then only this convolution operation between the input and output will give you, in between the input and the impulse response, will give you the output of the system. But in case the system is, suppose it's not time invariant, or suppose it is not linear, then obviously this convolution operation will not govern the relation between the input and the output. So in that case, we have to find out the relationship between the input and output from some other difference equation. So for an LTI system, as you can see, this h of n completely characterizes the system. If you know h of n, just by performing a single experiment on the system, you know everything about the system. So once you know that what should be the response of the system because of the application of a unit impulse function, once you perform this single experiment, you apply delta n at the input of an LTI system and you get the output as h of n. So once you perform this experiment, once you get the value of h of n, then you know everything about the system. You can find out the output of the system because of the any types of inputs. Because of any types of inputs, it's not only for x of n, it is true for x1n, x2n, x3n. So whatever be the input, whatever be the distribution of the signal sample over the time axis, you can easily find out the output just by convolving the input signal with the impulse response. And not only that, you can also say something about the causality of the system, whether the system is causal or not, about the stability of the system, whether the system is stable or not, just by observing the impulse response. But that is beyond the scope of our discussion, but I'm not going into that. But what I want to mention over here is, if you know h of n, the impulse response of any LTI system, then you know everything about the system. So the system is completely characterized by the impulse response. Now, coming back to the convolution function, as you can see, so this operation is basically performed inside the system itself, because the input to the system is x of k or x of n. And within the system, you have the property like h of k, or impulse response, or impulse function, impulse response. So this operation, this convolution operation, is basically performed inside the system itself. Then what about the different operations? Four different operations need to be performed to get convolution. These are nothing but the folding operation, shifting operation, multiplication, summation. And accordingly, for any digital filter, if I consider, so they have three basic units for the computation of the output. One unit is known as the multiplier unit, which can multiply the two signal sample. Then obviously the shifter unit, which can shift the input signal by some amount, by some bits, and then the adder unit. So multiplier, adder, and shifter. So these are the three basic building blocks of any digital filter. So you have these three different building blocks: multiplier, adder and shifter. Now let us now consider any digital filter for which we are going to calculate the impulse response. Suppose the input to the filter is say delta n. That is impulse function, unit impulse function, and we know that the output should be h of n. Now, as we have seen, the computation of output is performed through these operations: folding, shifting, multiplication, and summation. So here, delta n is the input to the system, and you know that delta n is a kind of function, unit impulse function is a kind of function which exists only for a single value of n. So if this is the n axis, then delta n will exist only for n is equal to 0, and otherwise the value is equal to 0. So this is nothing but delta n, the unit impulse function. Now, whenever you are going to apply this delta n function to digital filter, you will find that two different cases can happen. In one case, you will find that the impulse response or length of the impulse response is finite. You must be knowing what is meant by the finite length of any sequence. That means the lower bound and the upper bound. So their difference is finite. So I may consider that the lower bound is equal to say some m1 and the upper bound is say some m2. So you know what will be the length of the particular signal. That is nothing but m2 minus m1 plus 1. For this delta n function, impulse function, unit impulse function, the lower bound and the upper bound, both of them are same. Lower bound is also equal to 0 and upper bound is also equal to 0 because the signal exists only at n is equal to 0. So lower bound is equal to 0, upper bound equal to 0. So what will be the length of the sequence? That is 0 minus 0 plus 1, that is 1. So if I have a sequence like this, suppose I may be having a sequence like this. So this is the lower bound. So I may consider, suppose it could have been anything, either positive or negative. I may consider it as suppose minus 1. This point is say 0. This point is a plus 1, this point is a plus 2. Then what will be the length of the sequence? 2 minus or minus 1 plus 1. So length is 4. So you can readily observe the 1, 2, 3, 4. And outside this range, all the signal samples equal to 0. So the length is 4. 4 length sequence. Now, whenever you perform this experiment in order to characterize any filter, you'll find that in one case, the length of the impulse response will be finite, or finite length, I should mention finite length. And in other case, it will be of infinite length. And accordingly, we can categorize the digital filter into two different classes. One is known as finite or finite length. So length is not normally called finite length impulse response filter, which is in short known as FIR filter. And second one is the infinite length impulse response filter. That is known as IIR. So accordingly, the digital filters can be characterized in terms of the length of the impulse response into two different classes. One is the FIR filter, second one is IIR filter. So for FIR filter, the length of the impulse response is finite. That's why the FIR filter is always stable. However, the IR filter, for IR filter, the length of the impulse response is not finite. So the length is infinite. And as a matter of fact, there is a stability issue associated with the design of IR filter. Now let us first concentrate on the FIR filter first. Now, as you know, the digital filter, which are LTI in nature, can be completely characterized by the impulse response of the system. Not only in the natural domain, but also in the transform domain, we can completely characterize the system by means of its impulse response. Now, already you have seen that for any FIR filter, this relationship holds good, that yn is equal to xn convolution h of n. Now that operation is performed in the natural domain, natural time domain. Now if I move into the transform domain, if I apply the Z transformation on both sides of the equation, then what you will be getting is, you will be getting y of z here, and the convolution in the natural domain is equivalent to multiplication in the transform domain. So therefore, y of z is equal to, given by x of z multiplied with a sub z. And from that, we can find out a sub z that is equal to y of z upon x of z. And this h of z is known as the system function. System function of the particular filter. So this h of z, which is known to be the system function, is nothing but the z transformation of its impulse response. It's nothing but z transformation of h of n. So now if I go by the formula of z transformation, and let us assume that, so you must be knowing the formula for the Z transformation. That is H of n Z to the power minus n, where n is ranging from minus to plus infinity. But let us assume that we are talking about the impulse response of a finite impulse response filter and causal filter. So for a causal FIR filter, for a causal FIR filter, this will be, this equation will be modified, like inside the summation, you will be having the same thing, h of n z to the power minus n. But now here n will be ranging from 0 to some. Now this one is for the causality. Since it's causal, so that's why it starts from n is equal to 0. And because of the finite length, this limit is n. So here we find that the length of the impulse response is n plus 1, because it ranges from 0 to capital N. So the length of the impulse response is finite, that is n plus 1. So for any causal FIR filter, the system function can be written like summation n going from 0 to capital N, h of n z to the power minus n. Now there are certain properties, certain attributes which can be readily obtained with the aid of FIR filter and which you cannot obtain by means of IR filter. In fact, both of these two types of filters are having their own advantages and disadvantages. But one of the important advantages of FIR filter is that it is always stable. That is a very good advantage. And apart from that, the second important advantage of FIR filter over the IR counterpart is that the FIR filter, the coefficients of the FIR filter, I mean, if I just consider this impulse response coefficients is h of n, it can be selected in such a way that the FIR filter might exhibit linear phase characteristics. So whenever we talk about any filter, so let us consider any filter. Let's consider filter as a black box. Any filter, and we apply any input to it like x of n, and the output is say y of n. So what is the basic purpose of using a filter circuit over here? To extract some of the useful frequency components out of x of n, and just forget about the rest of the frequency components. So depending upon the type of the filter, whether it's a low pass filter, high pass, band pass, or band stop, a certain frequency band will be extracted. A certain frequency band will be allowed to pass through the system, and the rest of the frequency components will not be allowed. So they'll be simply rejected. So you may think that this filter is providing a variable gain to the different frequency components of the input signal. Now for a low pass filter, the gain provided to the low frequency component is large, and as the frequency increases, the gain provided by the filter to the high frequency component is small, and ultimately it is becoming zero. And the reverse thing will happen in case of a high pass filter. That means the gain corresponding to the low frequency component will be small, and however, the gain corresponding to the high frequency component will be large for a high pass filter. But whenever we talk about any filter, and as you can understand, the system function, it's a complex function, H of Z. So it not only provides some gain to the circuit, but also it will provide certain amount of phase difference, because this entire thing, as you know, is H of Z is Z to the power minus N, and this Z in a digital plane can be written as R e to the power j omega. In a digital plane, this Z can be written as R e to the power j omega. So this R part is the corresponding magnitude part, and omega part is the corresponding phase. So whenever you perform this particular mathematical calculation, H of N Z to the power minus N, so ultimately this H of Z is a complex function, and it is having its own magnitude as well as phase. So therefore, not only the different frequency components of Xn will experience different amount of gain by means of this filter circuit, but also the different frequency components will also experience different amount of phase lead or phase lag. And in regard to that, the design of linear phase filter is very much essential. What is the essence of linear phase filter? So if the phase function z to the power j omega, if the phase function, in fact, you can find out that the output h of z, that is the system function, can be written as, we can write this h of z, which is basically a complex function. So we can write like mod of h of z, that is the magnitude and the argument of h of z, or angle of h of z. So it is having two different components. One is the magnitude part, second one is the phase part. Now, if the phase can be obtained as linear function of frequency, that means if the phase phi omega, if I consider, so that is in terms of z, so accordingly from z domain, you can come back to the omega domain, and you can find out what is h of omega, and you can easily find out what is phi of omega. Now, if this phi of omega can be made as a linear function of frequency, some constant multiplied with some frequency like omega, then the advantage is that the corresponding group delay is fixed, because the expression for the group delay if I consider the expression for the group delay like tau g omega, that is nothing but minus dd omega of phi omega, where phi omega is the corresponding phase. Now, if this phi omega can be made as a linear function of frequency, some constant into omega, then obviously this tau g omega will be constant. So it is no longer dependent upon the frequency components. So as a matter of fact, the different frequency components which are present over here inside xn, in addition to having different amount of gains, the corresponding phase component is becoming a linear function of frequency. And as a matter of fact, the group delay to the samples provided by the filter circuit is becoming constant. So that is an important advantage of the FIR filter. And you can readily design the filter in such a way that the system function can exhibit linear phase characteristics. Now, I'll be demonstrating how can an FIR filter be synthesized so that the phase function can be made a linear one. Now, for this, I have to once again consider two different conditions. Whenever we talk about this h of n, now, depending upon the length of the FIR filter, in fact, the length is finite, but it could have been either even or odd. Now, depending upon the length of the FIR filter, and depending upon another important characteristics, that is the symmetricity or antisymmetricity, which might exist inside the impulse response coefficients, we can categorize the FIR filter into four different classes. So let me just try to figure out those classes, those types. So first is the type one. In case of type one, the length is odd. Length of the impulse response is odd. And at the same time, the impulse response experience symmetricity. So odd length and symmetric impulse response. So what do you mean by the symmetricity and what do you mean by the antisymmetricity? Now for symmetricity, this h of n can be written as h of capital N minus n for n less than or equal to zero, sorry, n less than or equal to zero, less than or equal to capital N. So that is all about the symmetricity. That means the first coefficient, that is h zero, is equal to h of n. H1 is equal to h of n minus 1, h of 2 is equal to h of n minus 2, and so on. That means there exists a symmetricity amongst the coefficients of the FIR filter. And obviously, for antisymmetricity, there should be a minus n outside. And moreover, the length is odd. So what do we mean by the odd length? Here, the length is n plus 1. So n plus 1 is odd. That means n is equal to even. So n is equal to even. So if n is equal to even, then n plus 1 would be odd. That means the length should be odd. Now let us assume that, let us assume n is equal to 8. So if n is equal to 8, then the length of the impulse response is 9. And then we can find out what is the system function. So system function h of z can be written as summation of h of n z to the power minus n. Now n is ranging from 0 to 8. So now if I just simplify the expression, it is like a0 plus h1 z to the power minus 1 plus h2 z to the power minus 2. So let me just complete this expression first. H3 z to the power minus 3 plus h4 z to the power minus 4 plus h5 z to the power minus 5 plus h6 z to the power minus 6 plus h7 z to the power minus 7 plus h8 z to the power minus 8. So this completes the overall expression for h z. Now, because of the symmetricity property, this h0 and h8, they are same. This h0 and h8, they are same. This h1 and h of 7, they are same. H2, H6, they are same. H3 and H5, they are same. So now if you combine these together, then we find it to be, so H4, Z to the minus 4 is kept alone. So this is nothing but H4, Z to the power minus 4. Plus, this h0 and h8 can be combined together. So I can simply write h0 into 1 plus z to the power minus 8 plus h1 z inverse plus z to the power minus 7 plus h2 z to the power minus 2 plus z to the power minus 6 plus h3 z to the power minus 3 plus z to the power minus 5. Now we can take z to the power minus 4 common from each of these expression, and ultimately we are left with, so h of z, if I take z to the power minus 4 common, then we are left with h of 4 plus h0 to z to the power 4 plus z to the power minus 4. Because you have 1 plus z to the power minus 8, so if you take z to the power 4 minus 4 outside, you have z to the power minus 4 plus z to the power plus 4. And then here you will find that it will be z to the power minus 3 plus z to the power plus 3, and so on. Then for h1, it will be z to the power plus 3 plus z to the power minus 3 plus h2 z square plus z to the power minus 2 plus h3 z plus z inverse. So that is the complete expression for h of z. So now we are interested in finding out the frequency response. Now you must be knowing that in order to find out the frequency response from the z transformation, the only thing that you need to do is that we have to compute the z transform on an unit circle. So as we know, z is given by r e to the power j omega. So if you compute this z transformation on unit circle, that means if you put r is equal to 1, if r is equal to 1, if you put r is equal to 1, then z is equal to e to the power j omega. That means you are computing the z transformation on unit circle. And accordingly, the response, what we'll be getting over here, is known as the corresponding frequency response of the filter circuit. So then the frequency response h of e to the power j omega can be written as, so here if you put z to the power, it is minus e to the power j omega, then here it will be e to the power minus j into 4 omega, and then here you have h of 4. Then here e to the power j 4 omega plus e to the power minus j 4 omega. So that is nothing but twice cos 4 omega. So you should write twice h 0 cos 4 omega plus twice h 1 cos 3 omega plus twice h 2 cos 2 omega plus twice h 3 cos omega. So now we are in a position to represent h of e to the power j omega, which is itself a complex function, into two different terms, the magnitude term and the phase term. So you must be noting the term inside this third bracket is a real number, because this h0, h1, h2, h3, h4, which are nothing but the impulse response coefficients, so they are obviously real. And this cos 4 omega, cos 2 omega, cos 3 omega, and cos omega, so all of them are real functions. So accordingly, whatever be there inside this bracket is a real function. So from that, we can easily identify what about the mod of h e to the power j omega. So mod of h e to the power j omega is nothing but mod of this entire thing. So I'm okay, let me once again write it down. H4, because that could have been negative depending upon the exact value of omega, and H0, H1, H2, H3. So it could have been negative, but can't be imaginary. So this is all about the magnitude. And what about the phase? So the angle of h to the power j omega. So e to the power j phi omega into mod h omega. So what is phi omega here? That is phi omega is minus j 4 omega. We can regard this as the phi omega, the phase function phi omega. Now, as you can see here, this phase function, in fact, I should introduce another term apart from this minus j 4 omega. Assuming that, if I assume that this entire thing inside this bracket is a positive quantity, then obviously the phase will be nothing but minus j 4 omega. If not, if this one is coming to be negative, then that can be regarded as a phase difference of pi. So therefore, I should add another parameter, and that parameter I may call this to be beta, and this is equal to the phase function, that is phi omega. Now this beta is equal to 0 or pi. Now if this term inside this bracket is positive, then obviously the beta is equal to 0. Only this part is contributing the phase, e to the power minus j 4 omega. And if not, if that part is coming to be a negative, so that can be written like, suppose this part is coming like minus 2 is entire thing. So this minus 2 can be written as 2 into e to the power minus j pi, 2 into e to the power minus j pi. So that component is coming over here as a phase. So ultimately, the phase function phi omega can be written as minus j 4 omega plus beta. So now, if you would like to calculate the corresponding group delay, so that group delay, you can easily find out from this expression by differentiating this phi omega with respect to omega and with a negative sign outside. And that is coming to be 4 here, so which is a constant term. Because beta is constant, so if you differentiate this beta with respect to omega, that will be 0 itself. And then The group delay that you are calculating from this particular expression is coming to be 4. That means it indicates a constant group delay of 4 samples. So irrespective of the frequency component, all the samples inside Xn will experience a group delay of 4 samples. And that is the beauty of having a linear phase relationship. And that you can establish by the fact that if the impulse response is symmetric and odd length, then this condition can be satisfied for now. However, if the impulse response is antisymmetric and even length and all other 3 different conditions, then also you'll find that this linear phase characteristics can be accomplished. So this linear phase characteristics has been proved for type 1 filter only. That means for odd length and symmetric filter. And let us try to observe what happens with the type 2 filter. In case of type 2 filter, the impulse response is even length and symmetric. Even length and symmetric. That is type 2. So I may assume that suppose n is equal to 7. Then under this condition, this h of z, following the same formula, it can be written like n is equal to 0 to 7 h of n z to the power minus n. So here you find that h0 and h7, they are same. h1 and h6, they are same. h2 and h5, they are same. And h3 and h4, they are same. What I can do is I can take h0 common, 1 plus z to the power minus 7 plus h1 z to the power minus 1 plus z to the power minus 6 plus h2 z to the power minus 2 plus z to the power minus 5 plus h3 z to the power minus 3 plus z to the power minus 4. So that is all about the system function of this FR filter. Now we can do some mathematical calculation so that that can be written in a compact form. So what can be done is we can take this z to the power minus 7 by 2 outside. If I take z to the power minus 7 by 2 outside, then we are left with h0. This one is z to the power plus 7 by 2 plus z to the power minus 7 by 2. Plus h1, if you take z to the power minus 7 by 2 outside, and you are left with, it should be z to the power 5 by 2 and z to the power minus 5 by 2. Plus h2, z to the power 3 by 2 plus z to the power minus 3 by 2 plus h3 z to the power half plus z to the power minus half. So once again, you can represent this entire thing in terms of the cosine function. So then this expression is becoming h of e to the power j omega. If you just find out the corresponding frequency response, and that is coming like e to the power minus j 7 omega by 2. And inside the bracket, you should have the first one is h0 into 2 cos 7 omega by 2. So this is 2 h0 cos 7 omega by 2, and accordingly, the rest of the elements can be written like 2 h1 cos of 5 omega by 2 plus 2 h2 cos of 3 omega by 2 plus 2 h3 cos of omega by 2. So once again, this one is a real function of frequency, and you can represent this h omega, h e to the power j omega, as the mod h to the power j omega with the corresponding angle to the power, h to the power j omega, the argument h to the power j omega. Then what about the mod? So mod is the modulus of this entire thing, 2h0 cos 7 omega by 2 plus 2sh1 cos 5 omega by 2 and so on. And what about the angle? Now we are mainly interested about the angle. So this mod of angle of h to the power j omega is nothing but minus j 7 omega by 2. Once again, you find that I think it is like minus 7 omega by 2. It's not minus j because it is written as j 5 omega. So it is like minus of 7 omega by 2. Plus you can consider some beta as usual, because if that part is becoming negative, then beta is considered to be pi, otherwise beta is equal to 0. Once again, you find that this phase function is made linear because of the selection of the impulse response coefficients of the FR filter. So now, what we can establish is for a symmetric impulse response coefficients, irrespective of the length of the filter, whether it's an odd length or even length, the impulse response, I mean the frequency response characteristics, which is nothing but the Fourier transformation of the impulse response of the filter. So that frequency response characteristics can be made a linear function. I mean, if I just consider the phase function, so that phase can be made a linear function of frequency. And therefore, the different signal frequency components of the input signal xn will not experience different amount of group delay. So they'll be having a constant group delay, and that is essentially governed by the length of the filter. Now, apart from this type 1 and type 2 filter, we have to explore the other two conditions, other two possibilities as well. And these are known as the type 3 and type 4. Now, as you have done for type 1 and type 2, it is for symmetric impulse response with odd and even length, respectively. Now, here, type 3 starts with the asymmetric impulse response with odd length. So, the same thing, we have odd length and anti-symmetric. Now, this time, instead of having symmetricity, we will be having anti-symmetricity amongst the coefficients of the FR filter. So what do you mean by the anti-symmetricity? So anti-symmetricity suggests that h of n should be equal to minus of h of n minus n for small n to be greater than 0 and less than equal to n. And if the length is odd, then n must be even. So I'm not going into the same calculation what you have done already. Rather, I would like to take, I would like to just concentrate on this part only. Now here, since it is anti-symmetric, so instead of having plus n over here, now h0 and h8, they are not same. Rather, h0 is equal to minus h8, h1 is equal to minus h7, h2 is equal to minus h6, and so on. So therefore, instead of having 1 plus something over here, you'll be having 1 minus. Here also, z to the power minus 1 minus z to the power minus 7. So instead of having plus over here, you'll be having minus. So over here, whenever you are calculating the frequency response, so e to the power like e to the power j 4 omega plus e to the power minus j 4 omega for type 1 filter. For type 3 filter, you will be having e to the power j 4 omega minus e to the power minus j 4 omega. So that cannot be written as a cosinusoidal function. Rather, that can be written as a sinusoidal function, sine of 4 omega. If we multiply 2j with the numerator as well as with the denominator, that means we will be having the same expression of h of omega. The only difference is that instead of having e to the power minus j 4 omega only, the another j is coming over here, and that j is nothing but e to the power j pi by 2, because e to the power j pi by 2 is equal to cos pi by 2 plus j sine pi by 2. So cos pi by 2 is 0 and j sine pi by 2 is equal to j. So whenever you have j over here, so j can be written as e to the power j pi by 2. So now I can, and apart from that, you have h4 over here. And instead of having cos function over here, you will be having a sine function. The other parts will remain as it is. So therefore, we can write the expression for h of omega directly instead of going into the almost same mathematical calculation. It is e to the power minus j 4 omega. And because of this pi, because of this j, you have e to the power j pi by 2. And then you have this part, h4 plus twice h0 sine 4 omega plus twice h1 sine 3 omega. I think you can just twice h1 sine 3 omega plus twice h2 sine 2 omega and lastly twice h3 sine omega. So once again, that part is a real function of frequency inside the bracket, and the phase function, this phi omega that we are talking about, is given by minus 4 omega plus pi by 2 plus beta. Now beta could have been either 0 or pi depending upon the polarity of this expression inside the bracket. And however, once again, we find that phi omega can be written as this minus 4 into omega. So it varies linearly with the frequency. So if you take the derivative of this phi omega with respect to omega, and then you'll be getting a group delay. So you'll be finding a constant group delay of 4 samples, just like the previous type of filter, that is for type 1 filter. Now with this understanding, let us move to the last type of the filter, that is type 4. Now for type 4 filter, the only difference is that here the length of the filter is even. So even length and anti-symmetric. even length and anti-symmetric. So once again, I must borrow the expression from the type 2. This one. So you have e to the power minus j 7 omega by 2. So instead of having a cos 7 omega by 2, you should have sine. And apart from that, you should be having some e to the power j pi by 2 outside. So and then the expression becomes h of omega, I mean h of e to the power j omega is equal to e to the power minus j 7 omega by 2 into e to the power j pi by 2 in order to account for this j. And then you have, let me once again check what was there for type 2. It was twice h0 cos 7 omega by 2. So it starts with twice h0 cos 7 omega. So there you have cos. Now this time you have sine, because you have an anti-symmetric impulse response. So twice h0 sine of 7 omega by 2 plus twice of h1 sine 5 omega by 2 plus twice h2 sine 3 omega by 2 plus twice of h3 sine of omega by 2. So as you can readily observe, the phase function pi omega being the same, minus 7 omega by 2 plus pi by 2 plus beta. So it will provide a constant group delay. So all of them are providing constant group delay. So therefore, the different frequency components will not experience a different amount of delays. So as a matter of fact, at the output of the filter, there will not be any phase distortion because of the constant group delay. So irrespective of the frequency samples, I mean the frequency component of the samples, so they will be having a constant group delay. I think I have already written in one of the slides what is the expression for the tau g omega, that is the group delay expression, minus dd omega phi omega. So as long as this tau g omega is constant, that means all the frequency components will experience the same amount of group delay. So at the output side, there will not be any overlapping. So what I mean to say is that, let me just conclude my today's lecture by just highlighting what we have done for the last few minutes. Suppose this is my filter circuit. Assume that it's a low pass filter, LPF. And suppose the input Xn looks something like that. Suppose this is my Xn, for example. So we find 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 9 samples. So it could have been more, it could have been less. 9 samples. And assume that out of these 9 samples, this sample, suppose this is my Xn. So let me identify this one first. So this is the X of n that we're applying over here. Suppose this black one is having a very high frequency component, and this one is having the low frequency component. So these samples, as identified by this ash color, they are corresponding to lower frequency components. And this black one, it corresponds to high frequency component. Now you're applying it to an LPF. Now you know that since The purpose or the objective of a low pass filter is to allow the low frequency component to pass and provide high attenuation to the high frequency component. So therefore, the gain provided to this components will be large as compared to the gain provided to this component. So that is essentially coming out of the mod of H e to the power j omega condition. But what about the phase? What about the group delay? Now assume that there is a group delay of 4 samples. Now under this condition, if there is a group delay of 4 samples, then what you expect over here is you can expect that all the samples will be delayed by 4 units. All of them will be delayed by 4 units. And suppose I may consider this to be say n is equal to 0, and here this is suppose n is equal to 3. Then you have, so their gain has been enhanced significantly. And for this component, for the high frequency component, this gain has been minimized. So that is the purpose of the LPF. So this is the output y of n. Now what we find is these low frequency components as identified by this gray color, so they have been enhanced. I mean, their magnitude has been increased significantly with respect to the magnitude of this black component. And this corresponds to the high frequency. I'm saying that this is a high frequency component. Let us assume this is a high frequency component, high frequency sample. And these are the low frequency samples. So their low frequency samples. So since they are the low frequency samples, so therefore, the gain provided by these low frequency samples should be large as compared to the gain provided to the high frequency sample. That can readily observe over here, and that is the purpose of the filter circuit. However, the high frequency sample gets seriously attenuated by means of this LPF, but there is not any overlapping. Since the phase is linear, so there is no overlapping, and there is a group delay, a delay of 4 samples. You find there is a delay of 4 samples. There is a delay of 4 samples. So there is no phase distortion taking place over here. And that you can only achieve if you go with a higher filter, finite impulse response filter, and if you design the filter in such a way that the impulse response coefficients exhibit either the anti-symmetric condition or the symmetric condition. So with symmetricity or anti-symmetricity only you can achieve this one. For example, if I assume that an impulse response HN looks like this. Suppose it starts with 1, then minus 2, then 4, then 7, then 4, then minus 2, then 1. So obviously, it exhibits symmetricity condition. That is fine. But if the impulse response exhibits like this, minus 3, 2, 6, 4, minus 2, 1. So as you can find, this one is a symmetric FIR filter. Now since it's symmetric, therefore, it can experience, and it is not symmetric. It's not asymmetric, rather it's not symmetric. That is important. Asymmetricity and not symmetricity is not the same. Asymmetric means just opposite of the symmetricity. If you have a plus 1 over here, you should have minus 1 over here. If you have plus 5 over here, you have minus 5 over here. And it is not at all symmetric. This one is not at all symmetric. 1, minus 3, 2, 6, 4, minus 2, 1. So there is only one sample gets replicated over here. But regarding the remaining samples, there is no question of symmetricity. So therefore, this particular expression of Hn is not at all symmetric. So therefore, you can have the linear phase response from this one. Linear phase response. But from this, not possible. Not possible to have linear phase response. So therefore, in order to have a linear phase response, you have to ensure either symmetricity condition or the asymmetricity condition. Or rather, I should say the anti-symmetricity condition. I should not use the term asymmetricity, because if I call like asymmetricity, that means it is not symmetric. Or you can call it to be asymmetric. Rather, just the opposite. So asymmetric. Not symmetric or asymmetric condition, asymmetricity condition. So with asymmetric impulse response, you cannot have a linear phase response for a Fire filter. But if you have symmetric or if you have anti-symmetric impulse response, then obviously you can easily design the linear phase Fire filter. Now with this, I would like to conclude our today's discussion. The primary discussion on the digital filter.